Hey folks, welcome to The Good, The Bad, The OMG. I'm your host, James, aka Wade D. McGinnis. Today we're going to be looking at and reviewing Dark Souls Prepare to Die Edition for the PC, and more specifically, we're going to be looking at Torius of the Abyss, the DLC content, actually. Now, this came out back in August for the PC, and I have finally sat down to play it. Now, I've actually clocked in over 90 hours on the console version, and I've clocked in over 60 hours on the PC version. And I'm still playing the game. I beat the game, both the original and the DLC, but I'm still playing it because it's just one of those games that's just that good. Now, today we're actually going to look, as always, the good, the bad, the OMG, but also at the gameplay, difficulty, story, audio, voiceover, soundtrack, graphics, performance, bugs, PvP, and just anything in general off on the side that had me go, oh, that's nice, or oh god, that's horrible. Gameplay and gameplay difficulty. Now, the good here is the core gameplay is still intact. There is a severe challenge you will undoubtedly have fun with. After beating the Sanctuary Guardian, the skill requirement for all three bosses remaining after that are very, very high. In fact, the second boss you're going to come across is Artorias himself, and he is aggressive. He's controlling the fight. He just is unrelenting. He will go after you time and again, and it forces you as a player to change up your strategy, and that is brilliant, and I love it. I will say that the Sanctuary Guardian himself is kind of eh, because he uses the lightning so much that I was just frustrated and irritated by him, but I still loved it. I still enjoyed it. Manos, the last boss, will have you literally tweak your understanding of trying to get behind a boss and staying on their back the entire fight. In this situation, it is a dumb move to do. Do not try to do it because you'll find yourself kind of getting stomped by him. Okay, so the bad though. Now, while the developers did a great job in ensuring that players will have to rethink their strategies, the second boss, Artorias, is the hardest boss, in my opinion, and because of that, the majority of players who are not skilled enough, that just enjoy Dark Souls, Demon Souls for the challenge, but they aren't up there with other hardcore players, will hit a wall, and they're going to hit it early, and it's going to hurt. Because the Sanctuary Guardian compared to Artorias, there is a huge, huge leap in skill and challenge, and because of that, it's going to crush a lot of people, and you're probably going to be forced to actually get some summons to get some help. I will admit, when I went on through my New Game Plus, I actually had to have help. I needed help. When I was fighting him on a normal, you know, brand new character, everything, I didn't have that much trouble. It took, you know, maybe, I think, 15 attempts to actually get used to his attacks, but I was able to actually finally defeat him. On New Game Plus, I got obliterated. After 52 deaths, I was like, you know what? I'm gonna get some help. I'll admit it, I'm gonna get some help. Now, story, players will actually find a familiar character. Princess Dusk, the one that you saved from her golden crystal form, is actually back in this game, in this DLC. This is actually, in many ways, her story as a branching point for you as a player to meet Artorias. Now, she's actually been taken by a dark, corrupted creature called Manos. It is up to you, you know, the undead chosen, to head back in time to Elysiel, where you'll meet the main star himself, Knight Artorias, and go over essentially everything, all the events that she talks about in the main game. And for the most part, the story is actually really good. I like the idea of seeing all the fleshed out, well, partially fleshed out, you know, ideas, and seeing them kind of expanded upon from the main game. Now, the oh my god moment of this, actually, because I honestly didn't see any bad parts to the story. I really didn't. I enjoyed all the good parts. I thought the story for what was there for the DLC is actually good enough to keep you kind of moving along. And it's well within the realm of what you can expect story-wise and kind of like depth-wise of a Dark Souls game and Demon Souls game. But the OMG part, literally, and spoiler warning, folks, spoiler, is you get to see a baby version Sif. So, you know, the wolf, Artorias's, like, pets. Yeah, you get to see a baby version of him, and if you go to help him, you are rewarded at the end of the DLC when you're fighting Manos. So keep in mind, try to find him, because it is awesome and it is amazing. And when you go to try to find him in the main game, if you have not killed him in the main game yet, it will not only rip out your heart, but it's going to rip your heart out and it's going to throw it on the ground and then stomp on it repeatedly. So beware, but enjoy. As with the original Dark Souls on the console, the PC version and the DLC content support amazing audio and soundtrack. The voiceovers of the actors and the actresses are stellar and fall perfectly in the world of Dark Souls. At no point will these characters like Hawkeye Gao or Marvelous Chester or even Saran fill out of place. And for the record, Michael Carter, who voices Gao, is amazing. I mean, the guy is just awesome. The character is amazing. But more importantly, fans of the original Demon Souls may have actually heard him already as the impressive, the awesome Bior of the Twin Fang. So if you started hearing Gao talk and you're like, wow, this guy sounds really familiar. Yeah, that's Bior, guys. Yeah, and it is awesome. He is amazing. I'm just going to say that. And as a side note, for those who don't exactly maybe like Marvelous Chester, or actually like him, but you've been wanting to beat him up without actually beating him up, go human. Go into right after beating Artorias of the Abyss. Go human and wait, because he'll actually invade. And then you get to pounce on him. And after you pounce on him, go talk to him. And he's going to be very upset. And it is hilarious. I love it. I really do. Since this is a direct port of the console, the visuals do not scale well with higher resolutions unless you download and install DSFix. This is a community mod that improves the visuals of the game. Many who have gotten the PC version are already aware of this amazing mod from a few individuals, if I remember correctly. And probably the best mod of the year, you know, just period. A group of individuals coming down and fixing a company's problem. Amazing. Now, once you have it in place, the new content found in Artorias of the Abyss is just amazing to behold, with like varied, you know, zones ranging from dark underground catacombs to a forest with a setting, the sun setting in the background. The visual diversity will literally just keep your eyes sated while you scream relentlessly at your monitor at your failings of dying and being killed and falling off a ledge by accident, or just rolling to dodge out of an attack only to fall off the ledge and then watch yourself die. So the graphics are good and amazing once you have the DS fix. It is the OMG of the graphics, and obviously the bad of the graphics, because without that the visuals look very pixelated and blurry, and it just does not look good without the DS fix. Performance, this is where the game is hit or miss. Now, for the most part, the areas that had trouble with frames, such as Blighttown, have been drastically improved. You're gonna see some really good frame rates out of the game. The better your computer, the better the frame rates, and just the smoother everything feels. It's great. The bad comes into the fact that if you want to summon somebody, if you want to invade somebody, if you want to find your friends, you can pretty much expect anywhere from 30 to 55 minutes of a wait time. And the reason for that is Windows Live for games and From Software just did not make the connectivity between users really viable. There's no fix for this right now. And it really doesn't look like the company behind the game is actually going to do anything. From Software is actually going to just let it be, because, well, the PC community wanted it, and we got it, which was great, but they just weren't going to support it completely. And it's tough, it's hard, and when you're looking for a friend, just know that while you may be able to see their summon sign, it's going to take effort and patience on your end to get them into your world. And just know that while you're waiting for your friend to get in, that you could be invaded, and then that invasion could stop, and then it's horrible, just plain horrible and almost non-excusable. So that's the bad part. The other bad part is the keyboard and mouse are no substitute for a controller. Don't even attempt to try to use a keyboard and mouse. Go buy yourself an Xbox controller or a PS3 controller, get the mods in your computer, and go from there, because if you attempt to use the keyboard and mouse, you're going to find so much frustration that it's just mind-boggling. Even after tweaking with the key bindings, it's horrible. It's really, really horrible. Now, PvP. So, PvP is still intact with this PC port. However, the addition of matches have been put into the game. Okay, so the downside is players, players that actually want into this structured PvP, where it's like one-on-one, you fall from a grate and you automatically go in and you start fighting, you gotta get through two bosses. First is the Sanctuary Guardian. He's kind of a pushover. If you played through the game, he's pretty much a pushover. Second boss is Artorias of the Abyss. He's not even close to being a pushover. So, for gamers that are wanting to immediately get into the PvP without having to invade or use objects to actually get into it, it's going to be a bit of a frustration and it's going to be kind of an annoying. But once you get past that, the PvP is just, it's good. It's really good. But personally, I found myself enjoying more of the original PvP. Having players invade your world when you go human is insanely fun, while terrifying at the same time. Just truly terrifying. If you're looking for an actual challenge, then go head-to-head. But if you want to be... Well, if you want to have a little fun, or if you want to tip the chance of winning in your favor when you get invaded, or have almost no honor, because, you know, that could be there. You could have no honor at all. You'd be like a troll. You could summon some allies, provided you can actually get them into your game. I did this a few times. Well, actually, not intentional. I should say this. I had three people, and I thought it'd be fun to see if I could get all three on a PC, which you can. I had up to three people in my group in total. And we had somebody invade us, and it was hilarious. He came running down towards me, realized there was two people, jumped off a ledge. And it was freaking hilarious. I messaged him like, yeah, sorry about that. I was just testing this, and we could have had a fair fight. It would have been cool. And he's like, it was very civil. It was great. It was actually very civil. And that was one of the niceties of Windows Live for games, is you can actually talk to your invaders. And in most cases, they're pretty civil. They're pretty nice, you know. They're cool people. And sometimes you can bring in your group and summon them. But it's great that the actual community for this game is there. So don't expect that there's no community. There is a nice, growing community. The bad, the big, oh my god, crap, bad part is you're going to have to deal with cheaters in this game. They're going to pop up. And with a new mod, it has made or allowed players to tweak and adjust their characters to the point where they're gods. If you notice that you're fighting an invader who's not taking any damage, yeah, you better get to reporting them, because otherwise they're not going to get away. They're going to get away with it, and they're just going to keep on doing their thing. So, just know that the PvP's there, it's good, but expect some bad apples. Alright, so actual, you know, bugs, glitches, and all of that, they're actually pretty much rampant in the game. They're not entirely game-breaking, but they can ruin your day, actually. Example being, when I was playing with my Now Playing series for the game, which you can actually check out on YouTube right now, I went to go backstab a enemy and ended up getting backstabbed by a wall. So that actually happened, and it's videoed, and it's shown, and me and Cal were looking at it and going, okay, that just happened, okay, that's weird. The camera dipping under the world and getting stuck under the world, that was annoying. That actually required me to exit out of the game entirely and then come back in. And then the occasional bodies getting, like, impaled in walls. But nothing really entirely game-breaking. Just still very, very frustrating. So, side notes. The game does require that you log into Steam and games for Windows Live. While I dislike Windows Live just because it has never really seemed to work with me, I always try to log in and disconnects, log in, disconnects. It's really annoying for me. But I actually did enjoy, when it was working, I actually really liked messaging people that, you know, I grouped up with, people that I killed, or just people that killed me, and just talking smack and having fun, and just it being there as an option. It was really nice, actually. I really did enjoy that. Making friends. I've already made, like, four or five friends, you know, within, like, the past 2 days of just playing just casually, and it's fun to get on there, have some fun. If I see them invade me, I immediately go off and we duel, we bow, we go through the whole thing, and we just kind of kick each other's asses. It's fun, it's good, it's good, wholesome fun. Now, the question whether to buy to buy the game, if the game's literally below $20 and you've been on the fence, buy it. Just buy it. It really is worth it. If you don't have a console, if you don't have PS3, you don't have Xbox, you never bought it, you never played it, but you've been eyeing the game the whole time, it's under $20. Buy the game. Just do yourself buy the game, because the DLC itself is $15 on the console, and it is just it's perfect. It works. You will enjoy it. You'll love it. Trust me. If you're wondering whether to pay the full price tag of $40 with the even though there's connection issues, there's problem with so many players, there is the potential for like some cheaters in the game and all of that, and that you still have to have a community mod to actually fix the visual problem, this is still a must-buy for any person that doesn't have a console. I really think that if you've been looking for a challenging game, you've been looking for something to bite your teeth into, this is something to get into. This is definitely a series that is worth your time, folks. Truly and utterly worth your time. If you guys like the video, go ahead and hit like, subscribe, do whatever you have to. If you guys don't like the video, hey, let me know in the comments below. Say, hey, you talk too long. Hey, you have a grating voice. Hey, you have a manly voice. You know, whatever it is, let me know. I will try my best to improve it. You can also check me over at GameBreaker.TV.com, where I do the general news. You can also check me over at GuildWarsInsiders.com, where I do the kind of news. And you can also check my other videos out. You know, the Good, the Bad, the OMG, Derp, Now Playing, Gaming Theater, The Fothra, Holocall. Good stuff on there, folks. So I will catch you next time. Later days.